Good afternoon, everyone, and welcome to this third of the lectures being beamed from this regional resource center. The topic was requested by the in the 150th birth centenary month of Gandhi. We have Dr. Nand, who was a faculty here as well as in Sri Chitra, and he will be speaking on the lesser known aspect of Gandhi's thoughts on modern medicine. So over to you, Nand, sir.
Good afternoon. Good afternoon. I suppose I'm audible. Yeah. Today we'll be speaking on the special aspect of Mahatma Gandhi's thoughts, how he has evolved into a great philosopher and a freedom fighter and a consummate politician. The title I have borrowed from another book called Gandhi's Challenge to Christianity by S.K. George. Incidentally, this book is very special. It has forewords written by Professor S. Radhakrishnan, who was the former President of India, and Mr. Horace Alexander. So it's a very special book. So I borrowed the title, part of the title from that book. Now, Gandhi is a very interesting person. That is because we borrow what Claude Makowitz has said. That he says that it is practically impossible to for somebody to write the biography of Mahatma Gandhi. That is because he says Mahatma Gandhi was a person who went on reinventing himself. So if you look at Mahatma Gandhi in his childhood, there is one Mahatma Gandhi. Then there is another Mahatma Gandhi in Britain, another one in South Africa, and perhaps two or three Gandhis in his struggles in India. So he went on reinventing. He went on through a process of evolution. So that makes Mahatma Gandhi very special. And for the same reason, we also find that he is very influential even after his death. Even in the 21st century, people think about it. So that is one unique feature of Gandhi. And Markowitz also says that at present, by 2017, when he wrote this, there has been more than 500 biographies of Mahatma Gandhi in the English language alone. So that's a very important achievement by for anybody. So now you should know that he is now dead for more than 70 years, and there are books coming out about Mahatma Gandhi even today. So I shall show you one or two books which were published in 2018 and 19 as we go on. So he is current. Somehow he touches our minds with his with this contemporariness. That is very unique about Mahatma Gandhi. And the other aspect of Gandhi is that he had a very large canvas to cover. So he had worked and he had reacted to lots of issues, and he responded to many queries. He responded to many situations, and he was actually discussing various unrelated topics and subjects and specialties. So all these things make Gandhi or Gandhism a very unique unique subject by itself. And it's our privilege that we have Gandhi, and we could live when the memory of Gandhi is still there. So, and this I would say that for this present talk, I would say that this statement of Gandhi should be taken as Gandhi's the testament of Gandhi. He says, "I do like everything that is ancient and noble, but I utterly dislike a parody of it." So look at that. He says, whatever is old and noble are very good, but not as parody. And I must respectfully refuse to believe in that ancient books are the last word on matters treated in them. As a wise heir to the ancients, I am desirous of adding to and enriching the legacy inherited by us. So he was a very dynamic person. He doesn't believe that whatever is said 1,000 years ago are sacrosanct at the present moment. You have to rewrite, like your principles of Harrison. becomes rewritten several times. So principles of anatomy becomes rewritten. It is not the way Gray conceived of anatomy many years ago in the 19th century. So it's not different. So that way, Gandhi also says that you have to reinvent. It has to be rewritten and new ideas have to come in. And Gandhi refuses to accept anything that is old just because it is old. So that is one of the Gandhi testaments. So whatever he says later should be compared with this statement. So it is on this basis that I shall proceed with my talk. So in the remaining part of my presentation, I will be telling you how Gandhi has understood modern medicine and how he has compared modern medicine with other forms of medical care and how he places modern medicine in various social strata. So this is one of the articles published about Gandhi's view on science, especially medicine. This article was written by Dr. Prasad as part of his PhD in the IIT Delhi. It is presented, part of the article was presented in the Economic and Political Weekly, which is a very prestigious journal in India. There were detractors for Gandhi. There were many people who thought Gandhi was very outdated during his own time. So some people were these people, very famous people. Aldous Huxley was an immensely popular person in the 19th century or 20th century. He said Gandhi is outdated. He is anti-science. And Aldous Huxley also famously said that if you follow Gandhi, you will be killing 80 crore people. Because Gandhi's vision of science cannot be compatible with the existing scenario of the world. And Aldous Huxley believed in science. He said the immense progress of science, we could increase the population 3 or 4 times during the 50 to 70 years. And Gandhi would, if you follow Gandhi's principles totally, then it will be retrograde. That's what Aldous Huxley said. Similarly, one of our pioneers in planning, Nirmal Kumar Bose, also had the same view. The other very important person who opposed Gandhi's ideology was Meghnad Saha. Some of you might have heard of his name. He was a very brilliant physicist who is supposed to be a Nobel category physicist, but he just missed the Nobel Prize in spite of different people recommending him. So he is better known for his research in astrophysics, how ionization happens in space. Later he became a member of the planning commission. He is part of the planning board, planning commission, while Nehru was the prime minister. So these people did not approve of Gandhi's analysis of the world at those times. Now these are the two positions that we can think of. Now how did Mahatma Gandhi look at modern medicine? Well, most of what Mahatma Gandhi said or did happened between 1920 and 1948, because in 48 he died. So this was also the time when modern medicine was also not what we are seeing now. Modern medicine was just evolving. It was just coming. It was getting modernized. So tremendous amount of modernization happened in modern medicine from the late 19th century to early 20th century. Let us say from 1890 or 1885 to 1920 was a very significant period of growth. So Mahatma Gandhi was at the doorsteps of that growth. So that is the situation, that was the level at which modern medicine was standing. So in India, many of the important changes of modern medicine had not come. Most of the changes, most of the discoveries, inventions of modern medicine happened in the West, in Europe or United States, America. And these changes could be implemented there, but not in India. It had not percolated sufficiently deep into the Indian subcontinent. So we had at that time various types of medical systems, what we call today as Ayush. For example, we had Ayurveda, we had Unani, we had Homeopathy, and these systems were in vogue. And perhaps an ordinary person might not find that modern medicine was significantly better than the other systems. So that was at that time, because antibiotics had not been, just been discovered. One antibiotic has just been discovered and not available in India. And many people still used to die of infections. And cholera was almost something, a recurring event every year. A lot of people died with due to influenza, cholera, plague, and things like that. And leprosy was extremely rampant. So this was the situation. And during that time, one of the ashram Antevasi, somebody who was staying in the ashram, is Mary Barr, who was staying with Mahatma Gandhi, had a problem. She was admitted to hospital. And then Gandhi wrote a letter to her. He said, "I believe you should accept the prevailing treatment, which is modern medicine. You should accept the prevailing treatment and get well. Injections are becoming common these days. So just look at the time. I just wanted to point out that this is a time during which they lived. Injections are becoming common these days, and you should accept them. If you do not need Neera's help," Neera is another person in the ashram, and Neera was actually an attendant to Miss Mary Barr. And Gandhi was saying, "If you do not need Neera's help, let her come back. I know that in good hospitals, doctors are wary of too many attendants." So look at that. The hospital management is slowly evolving. Modern medicine is getting shape. It is putting its roots down. And Gandhi is responding very positively. So this is the Gandhi that is the real Gandhi, but not the Gandhi that we thought of as if he is regressive and he's old-fashioned and did not know anything, and he was interested in naturopathy, etc., etc. This letter written to her in 1933. So this is another letter a few days later. He refers to a telegram. "I had mentioned in my telegram that I can easily arrange for your x-rays to be done." X-ray was one of the most important investigations at that time, 1993. One of the most advanced testing was x-ray, to be done either in Bombay or in Nagpur. "But I understand that these instruments are available in Wardha as well. But please follow the advice given by your friends over there." So this is how Gandhi treated the situation at that time. Now, Gandhi also wrote a similar letter to Jawaharlal Nehru, because his wife Kamala was actually sick. She was in Europe at that time. And he was saying, "I wish Kamala would make good progress from her recurrent pains. If doctors are willing to do the surgery on her, I would indeed have agreed to that adventure." This is how Gandhi responded. So surgery is not a simple thing in 1929. It's earlier than that. So 29 surgeries are difficult. We do not have this type of advanced anesthesia and things like that. So things were difficult. So Gandhi actually responded like that. Similarly, now I'll just take you to, you now understand how Mahatma Gandhi saw modern medicine. Now, how does he see Ayurveda and modern medicine as two systems of medicine? Now, he always felt that Ayurveda and Unani had a special place in India. That is because they are homegrown. So they understand the Ayurveda system and Unani system, or to understand the needs of the people. Not only that, the Indian people were highly religious during that time. They had connections to their roots. They had certain type of sentimentality. They had certain sort of socialized behavior, which is unique to the people here. And therefore, Gandhi thought that these systems have a relation between the science and religion, and therefore between the body and soul. And therefore, Gandhi thought these are good systems. Secondly, Gandhi also thought that there is nothing to choose between them, because modern medicine was not that very strong as you find it now. It is still early days for modern medicine. So if you can strengthen Ayurveda and Unani, it could evolve into some sort of a very strong system, which would be economical, accessible, and people could understand what is happening, because the modern medicine is entirely in a different language. So you need to have a different language, different type of set of rituals, so people would not be very comfortable with it. So therefore, what he particularly was bothered about was that he wanted the spirit of research in Ayurveda and Unani. And he found that to be missing in Ayurveda and Unani. So he said that, of course, we have a very great system from the past, but we have to make it into a contemporary, workable, dynamic science. That's what you should do. That is what Gandhi always wanted to do. And that was the complaint that he always had against Ayurveda and Unani. We shall just go into some of those. So he was asked to inaugurate the Chibiya College in Delhi, which is an Ayurveda college. 1921 was very early days for Gandhi's activities in India. You should know that. And then he point blank told them, you just read this, it's a very important document. I regret to have to record my opinion based on considerable experience that our Hakims and Vaidyas do not exhibit that spirit of spirit in any mentionable degree. They follow without question the formulas. They carry on little investigation. The condition of indigenous medicine is truly deplorable. This is what Gandhi's opinion was. Unlike what people had, this was the speech he gave. But look, the important point is that Gandhi never said it in a modern medicine hospital. When he visits Ayurveda hospital, he would find the weakness of Ayurveda. So he always wanted to be inside a system to correct it. So he was not a saboteur. He never wanted to sabotage a system from outside. He would want corrections from inside. So this is one of the principles that Gandhi always followed in his life. So that is meticulously learned. So this is part of the complete works, volume 19. Now, again, he continued, that not having kept abreast of modern research, their profession has fallen largely into disrepute. The Ayurveda profession has fallen into disrepute. I am hoping that this college will try to remedy this grave defect and restore Ayurveda and Unani medical sciences to its pristine glory. I am glad, therefore, that the institution has a Western wing. The Western wing means the modern medicine wing. It also is. So make use of that and then make research happen. And let the results of research come and enhance your own specialty. That is what Mahatma Gandhi was saying. After a couple of years, he was invited to give two speeches. One at Madras Ayurveda Pharmacy and the Ashtanga Ayurveda Vidyalaya, Calcutta. He blasted them also. He minced no words there. He stated his criticism of the Vaidyas. The large-scale advertisements of Ayurvedic tonics as sexual stimulants. This is happening today and it happened in 1925 also. The large-scale advertisements of Ayurvedic tonics as sexual stimulants as proof that Ayurvedic physicians were trying to capitalize on the past glories of Ayurveda for the market without any genuine research. Second point he made was the fact that there was no association of Ayurvedic physicians that protested against this immoral business and ethical practice. This is what was said. See, look at that. He was an ethicist before ethics came to India. So he understood medical ethics even before ethics came to India. So for example, if there is an unethical event happening in medical science in our hospital, there should be a whistleblower. There should be, the correction should come from inside. He was complaining that, look at that, all these Ayurvedic physicians were advertising their products as if they will enhance the sexual potency of Indians. And then you don't find any Ayurvedic physicians coming out and saying, said, no, this should not be done. See, this is the correction that he wants. This is the correction that does not happen there. So he finds fault with them. And he goes to the Ayurvedic conclaves, he goes to the Ayurvedic conferences and tells them, this is how it is. So after these two speeches, one of the very important Ayurvedic physicians of Calcutta, one Professor Kaviraj Gananath Sen, he challenged Gandhi. And he asked Gandhi to come and clarify his stand on Ayurveda. That's a spelling mistake, I'm sorry about it. So Gandhi replied that many Ayurvedic physicians are mere quacks. It is very, very, very clean. He said many of the Ayurvedic physicians are mere quacks and claim much more than what they know. So he was very specific and very candid and direct about what he said. And he said, I know of not a single discovery of invention of any importance on the part of Ayurvedic physicians as against a brilliant array of discoveries and inventions which the Western physicians and surgeons boast of. Nothing has happened in India. So that makes their science weak and ineffective. They have not created a contemporary Charaka Samhita. Look at that. He said, Charaka Samhita is there. You still follow that. but it has not been made contemporary. You have not revised it. You have not taken new knowledge and put it there. So this is how Gandhi saw this thing. And Kaviraj, this is the answer he gave to the professor Sen of Ayurveda. The other interesting thing about Gandhi is that he was a constant learner. He went on asking questions to other people. He was not a qualified physician. He did not know biology. However, he went on asking the appropriate persons to learn himself, because this is something which helped him to reinvent himself. So one of his contacts was Dr. Richard Gregg, with whom he had a lot of correspondence. So if you search the net for correspondence between Gandhi and Gregg. So he used to call Gregg by some other name, by Govinda or something. I think Gregg was known as Govinda to Gandhi. So there are Govinda-Gandhi communications. So he always asked Gregg. So Gregg sent Mahatma Gandhi a book on vitamins. That was in 1927. You know when the vitamins were discovered? The first vitamin was discovered in 1914. So he's quite contemporary there. So the first vitamin. And the other vitamins were slowly coming up. So, and most of these discoveries were in the West once again. So in India, we simply have heard of vitamins, maybe as a newspaper report, but Gandhi was very current. So he says, I read your book and I enjoyed reading it. And I can't say I fully trust it. So he doesn't bother about authority. See, this is one of the fallacies of, if you look at the fallacies of an argument, one of the fallacies is that going back to authority. So you refer to an authority and try to establish a doctrine. So Gandhi doesn't do that. He has nothing to do with authority. You should have proof. So he says, vitamins, if you claim that vitamins can do all these things that you are saying, it needs more proof. And for getting more proof, you need more research. Where are those researchers? And he says the author rejects vegetarian food. This author says all vitamins can come only from non-vegetarian products. Gandhi says that is not true. And there are extremely good vegetarian products like seeds, nuts and pulses. What happened to them? What vitamins do they contain? The book doesn't say that. Research on vegetarian food can only be conducted in India because we have lots of vegetarians here. But most of your research happened in Europe. So look at that. How relevant he has understood science. So Gandhi is actually talking science when he is dealing with modern medicine. So Gandhi remembers when he was in England, there was a long drawn fight between two groups of people, nutritionists. One group said eating white bread is always better. The other group said eating brown bread is always better. Now, this fight was in the 19th century. Of course, we know the answer now. Let us not go into that. In Gandhi's time, this was a major fight. Both groups fought with passion. And none of them was able to prove it because they could not enlist sufficient number of human volunteers to do a study. So, study was not done. However, Gandhi's friend, Dr. Allinson, did an experiment on his dogs. He had two dogs. So he took one dog and that dog was fed with white bread and water for 1 month. The other dog was fed with brown bread and water. At the end of 1 month, the one that was served with white bread died. The other survived. So this appears to be a proof. But for Gandhi, this is not proof enough. So that's the interesting part of Gandhi. So on the face of it, it appears as though it's good. We have proof that brown bread is good. Now, Gandhi says, we are not sure if the experiments were controlled. Controlled experiment is a very, very contemporary word. You hear it only now. Gandhi said, we do not know whether it's controlled and observed well. We are not sure if the health of the dogs were similar to the day one. See, this is how controlled studies are done. He's almost on the verge of saying RCT. Almost. See, he predated many of the intellectuals. This is what Gandhi is about. This is what we should understand about Gandhi. This is what Gandhi becomes a passion for many people who had a direct relationship with him. And he said so. And then now I'll take you to another area that is very close to ethics research and medical research. And how does Gandhi look at medical ethics? No, once again, back to 1927, there was a very important controversy. The case of Dr. Harold Blazer. He was a doctor, practicing doctor, and he had a girl child with a disability. And when Dr. Blazer thought that he was nearing his own end due to old age, he chloroformed his daughter. That means he did a, what we now would call it as a mercy killing. So he ended her life because after he dies, there is nobody to look after the child, the girl child. So he didn't want that child to go into a problem. So, of course, there was a case after that. There was litigation. And he stood trial. And the jury acquitted Dr. Blazer. So one of the people who was reading Gandhi's journals wrote to him. He said, he asked Gandhi to react on this. And then challenged Gandhi, if he would want to be alive and be cared for, if he were to go blind and deaf altogether and useless. Suppose you have a useless life, would you still want to be alive, or would you not want to die? So this was the question posed to him. So let us see how he tackled that question. He said, the jury is right, because that is the law. If that is the law, it is okay. But Blazer is wrong, because Blazer does not only has a legal responsibility, he also has a moral responsibility. So morally, Blazer is nowhere near the correct position. Dr. Blazer did not show the trust and goodness in humanity. There are lots of methods by which you could have taken care of your daughter, but he did not go into them. And does not medicine now claim that there is no incurable disease? Or conversely, does not medicine claim that we can look after the patients until they die? If that is so, where is the scope of this mercy killing or euthanizing or chloroforming the daughter? That is Gandhi's question. The second question Gandhi says is that, imagine that a young doctor goes up to a patient and finds that the patient is too sick and will not survive, and he chloroforms the patient, and then the senior doctor comes and finds that there is something and then the patient can survive. What is your recourse to that? How can you manage it? So how can you correct the wrong decision? So he said this Blazer is wrong. Now, this is self-same question that we are asking in medical ethics class. Any one of our ethics class, this will be the question. The same question, and we will be approaching the question from what Mahatma Gandhi approached, the method by which Mahatma Gandhi approached the question in 1927. Today, it is 2019, nearly 100 years later, the issue remains. Gandhi says, now about himself, the second part of the question is that suppose you become useless, blind and deaf, then what will you choose? So he says, he expects the countrymen to look after him if he becomes blind and deaf and a burden to others. But the critical point there is, would I want to be alive like that or not, is the critical question. It is not as though you simply ask other people to look after me. The question is, when everything is gone from me, would I still want to be alive? This is the question. You can answer this question only when you know this. Would it be good if all lepers, of course those words were used in 1927, right now we don't use the word leper, blind and deaf, etc. We have other better words for them. Would it be good if all lepers, the blind and deaf, are killed because they are not good enough? And please remember that Damien was a leper, Milton was blind. So man is not a body. That's what Gandhi concluded. So this is how Gandhi approaches an ethical issue. So it was a remarkable ethics, and when you look at that, you find it difficult to imagine that he has not studied medicine. So that is how it is. And there is another interesting discussion between Gandhi and Sir Robert McHarrison. Sir Robert McHarrison was a Government of India officer. Government of India means Britain. Britain was the government. So he had written, he is one of the topmost officers under the British Empire, and he wrote a food primer for Indian children, Indian young people and children. It's called the food primer. That was a recommendation for essential nutrition for children. So Gandhi went through the book and they said, I approve of that, but criticized its focus on milk and meat. Sir Robert's letter, so when the criticism came, Dr. Sir Robert wrote a letter to Gandhi saying that he is right and Gandhi is wrong. So what Gandhi did was, he took that letter and published it in his journal so that everybody can read the letter. That's number one thing that he did. He doesn't hide anything. He simply put it in the something like putting right now, if it were today, he would have put it in the web. So, okay. And then he wrote down why he referred on various areas. 1, 2, 3. And Gandhi is very methodical in doing that. And he said, scientists had only begun to investigate the hidden possibilities of innumerable seeds, leaves and fruits, which is true. Tremendous vested interest have grown around the belief of animal food. Look at that. And that prevents doctors from approaching the question with a complete detachment. The same thing that is part of research today. You see, if I have to present a paper, I will say how my research funding is connected to other agencies. Do I have anything to report? I have to declare my various associations and connections. And Gandhi is saying this. How are you sure that this is not vilified or influenced by various agencies that has propagated this book? Book is okay, I approve everything, but I do not know that this is true. It's another area of what Gandhi has proposed. And once again, this also happened in 1930. So, very early days for anybody else to think of it. And there are other statements by Mahatma Gandhi about modern medicine. One thing that struck Mahatma, he was not a great supporter of modern medicine in practice. That is because modern medicine in practice was very expensive. And people did not have the faith in it. And the language barrier was so strong that there was an architectural type of attitudinal barrier between the English physician and the ordinary Indian citizen. So therefore, these are the issues where Gandhi found it difficult to accept it. But also Gandhi thought that if Ayurveda and Unani and Homeopathy would become stronger, or naturopathy for that matter, at that time the word naturopathy was not there, if these systems become stronger, perhaps this could be a viable system during that time. Now, Gandhi, however, was impressed by the curiosity of medical scientists, their willingness to study, willingness to take up challenges and find answers to the problems. So, he was very passionate about how modern medicine scientists worked on issues, tried to find answers to various issues. And more importantly, he was impressed by the humility of scientists when they were proved wrong. Especially, of course, research were happening in Europe or America, not in India. But then, whenever they are proved wrong, they used to accept the fact that they are wrong. The ability to accept what went wrong was a great quality, as it appeared to Gandhi. And he puts forward a very important principle in science. He has anticipated what Karl Popper would say perhaps 10 years later. This happened in 1926, and Karl Popper's book on falsification would appear in German language in 1934. This is Karl Popper, who has made the most astounding theoretical model on what constitutes science and non-science. According to him, the critical thing in science is not proof. If I say that paracetamol can cure headache, that's not enough. He says that there should be what is called as falsification, something to falsify, something to say it doesn't happen. For example, you have evolution. Why do you say evolution is true? Evolution is true because we have a lot of experience in it. But if you can find the body of a rabbit or a fossil of a rabbit in paleontological period, then evolution goes. Evolution is falsified. So hypothetically, the concept of falsification is very, very critical to science. And that is what Gandhi was referring to. And the Karl Popper wrote his Logic of Scientific Discovery in German language in 1934. And its English translation came only in 1959. So Gandhi beautifully anticipated Karl Popper. That's one of the remarkable thing about Gandhi and medical research and medical ethics. And after Popper, science became like this. So Popper, before Popper, after Popper. Before Popper, everything that you experience is science. But after Popper, all knowledge will be divided into scientific, non-scientific. Now, non-scientific will be once again divided into two, pseudo-scientific like astrology, creationism, all these things. And there are unscientific things like literature, which cannot which doesn't require falsification. So aesthetics, all these things come under philosophy, all these come under unscientific things. Which is, they are not science. There is no science. So you can put that test of falsification and say whether something is science or something is not science. For example, if I say that all swans are white, it's something that you cannot prove. You have to go on counting all the swans in the world to say, find out if there is one black swan anywhere in the world. So it's practically not possible. So it cannot be proved. So once you stick to such sciences, it is very difficult to prove. So you can take a pauper's knife and say that this is non-scientific, non-science. So this part is science. So Gandhi anticipated pauper. And Gandhi also looked at the question of life and non-life. One of the important things that Gandhi was interested in, if you are a vegetarian, can you eat eggs or not? So he went through this question for many years. Ultimately, he said, yeah, if you can eat egg, then you can compare egg with milk. So milk is something that you are, because by taking milk, you are not harming, you are not causing harm to an animal. So you can take milk. So by taking egg also, you are not really harming an animal. So you can eat that egg. Now, he was interested in finding out the question, can you call an egg a living organism, or is it life or non-life? So he was confused about that. And finally he said, for the sake of clarity, he said, if it's a vegetarian egg, the egg which is, what is it, haploid, that egg is okay. So that is final thing. But then he approved of anybody who chose to eat egg. So the question, where does life start, is a very interesting ethics issue even today. We do not know when, for example, if you are dealing with the ethics of abortion, for example. We do not know when you can do an abortion, what point of time when you should not do an abortion, because that's when an embryo or a fetus becomes a person. So when does the fetus acquire personhood is something that he is asking. So if the egg is a person or a chick or a particular animal, then you cannot kill it. If the egg is not, you can have it. So he deliberated on such issues. The other major area that Gandhi was interested in was animal experimentation. So during Gandhi's time, especially not after 1920, but if you take the time between 1890s and 1920, that period, the 30 years, the world was actually divided on by scientists who would do animal experimentation, and they were called vivisectionists. So the cutting open an animal is called vivisection. So you support vivisection, you oppose vivisection. So there were very strong campaigns against vivisection or animal experimentation. There were strong campaigns in favor of animal experimentation. So Gandhi had his own very important position there. And this came, interestingly, there was a case against Immanuel Klein, who supported vivisection. So in the case, when there was a discussion, when you had to face a board, these were the questions and these were the answers. If you read carefully, you'll find that these are dangerous answers. When you say that you use them, because Klein was doing his procedures, experiments, anesthesia was already discovered. So when you say that you use them, anesthetics, for convenience sake, do you mean that you have no regard for the suffering of animals? No regard at all, was the question. Now imagine that somebody answers like that today. No. Are you prepared to establish that as a principle on which you approve yourself? Yeah. And his answer is, I think with regard to an experimenter, a man who conducts special research, he has no time, so to speak, for thinking what the animal will feel or suffer. So he used to do anesthesia. So when does he do anesthesia? When, by doing anesthesia, it becomes easy for him to control the animal. That is when you do anesthesia. Otherwise, the pain of the animal was not important to him. He never bothered about it. So this particular case became a big major issue all over Europe. And a lot of people, some people came behind him. Some people opposed him. So there was a big dialogue about it. In the same way that we have gene splicing now, you use CRISPR and cut gene and then manipulate it. Do you agree or not? We do not know. Can you do certain types of surrogacy? We do not know. So these are issues. See, there was a major issue in Canada 2 decades ago when a man had donated his sperm in to a cement bank. After some time, he died of a traffic accident. And years later, his wife went to the cement bank and said that she inherited that cement. Bank said it is donated. No, it is an estate by him and she inherits the cement. So finally, there was a case and then she got it. And then she wanted to become pregnant with their cement. The church interfered. Church said, you cannot have a baby whose father is no more. The father should be alive. So this was a major issue at that time. So issues like that open up major ethics crisis, a lot of discussion. This was one of them at that time, during Gandhi's time. And this was around 1910 or early, maybe before that. Because Klein himself died in 1925. Now, a lot of people supported vivisection, like Pasteur, Lister, Bernard, all these people supported, lots of others. And in fact, by 1920, the people who did not support vivisection practically were not there. All people supported by 1920. So, Karl Marx is one person who did not support vivisection. Darwin did not support vivisection. Bernard Shaw did not support vivisection. They were opposing it. Now, Gandhi had a particular position. Now, his position, of course, is against vivisection. Animal experimentation, he did not like, he did not approve. Throughout his life, he did not approve. But the reasoning is unique to Gandhism. If you look carefully to the reasons, he said, I dislike vivisection with my entire soul. I am against it. I detest the unpardonable slaughter of innocent life in the name of science and humanity. And all the science discoveries stained with innocent blood is bad. That is with respect to animals. And I see the day dawning where the honest scientist of the West will put limitations upon present methods of pursuing knowledge. He said, I hope that the scientists will eventually find out something else. So he gives us a little leeway there. He says that please find out something else to do research. So it is the next section that one should look very, very carefully. Now, he says that when you approve of vivisection, you are actually putting animals into a sort of hierarchy. Some animals are less moral than others. If you put animals into a sort of hierarchy, for example, rats can be considered to be less moral, so you can easily kill rat. A dog can communicate to human beings, so a dog will be ranked higher, so you might not kill a dog, or you might not kill an elephant or a lion, but smaller animals will be killed. He extrapolates this to human life. He said, if research will happen in animals, research will happen also in human beings. And when research is carried, extrapolated into human beings, it will be the lowest of mortals in the human beings who would be put into research. This is his concern. So research will come to Eastern countries, into Asia and African nations. And you will find that just like lower order people are, animals are subjugated, the people who cannot resist will also be subjugated. And actually this happened. This happened in Tuskegee in 20th century. This happened in Germany where Hitler made elaborate laboratory procedures to kill Jews. A lot of experimentation happened. In fact, a lot of German children were killed because they had cerebral palsy or mental retardation by calling it science. So these things really happened. So Gandhi somehow predicted this. So this is how research will happen. So that is why Gandhi, there are no safeguards. So he was bothered about safeguards as it applied to human being. And as far as animal is concerned, he was concerned about their life. For Gandhi, the real challenge of science, the other important thing that Gandhi found out, that he says the other, the concept of the other, Or today we always speak about us and them. The whatever I identify as us belongs to a category. Whoever does not belong to the group of us belongs to an alienated being. So alienation, marginalization is something that Gandhi understood. And of course the word marginalization, subjugation, all these things were not popular during Gandhi's time, but he has elaborated on that very, very, very clearly. So he said, so if you want to do research, do it on your own self. So identify the self and do research, and only then you can approve of it. So, and then therefore, he said, work with your hands, because you have another community who is working with your hands, and most of the people who learn science come from middle class or upper middle class people who do not work, and most of the researches happen to people who work with their hands. So come down and do something. So, I got this from this particular reference. And this is one of the important paintings that happened at that time. This is actually vivisection of a dog happening without anesthesia. And if you look carefully, all the people standing around and looking at it are not bothered about the suffering of the dog. They are simply disinterested witnesses to the experiment that is happening. So this is one of the important secular painting by Emil Edward Mushi. Yeah, by 1920, of course, the vivisection is actually won the war. Animal experimentation was very, very, very popular. It happened, and then people could not resist animal experimentation. And also discoveries happened, because you know that all the vaccines, Louis Pasteur, germ theory, all these things came. So, of course, there is no stopping them. But then, lot of animal rights activists came, like Peter Singer wrote about the liberation of animals. So, lot of other things came. Carson wrote about the silent spring. So all these things gave another life to, by the time Gandhi was not there, but then the idea that the smaller animals and smaller insects should be protected became very strong in later time. And of course, as I said before, mice and rats were always seen as despicable creatures. So they could be slaughtered for research. And of course, laboratory produced its own type of mice and rats. So, laboratory bred mice also occurred. So, that helped research to happen. The other area where Gandhi is said to be very backward is reproductive rights. Some of you must have heard of Margaret Sanger, who worked on reproductive rights. She is one person who actually wanted to differentiate sex for procreation and sex for enjoyment or social life. So she always said that these two are different, and women should have the choice of pregnancy. They should become pregnant only when they choose to become pregnant. So this was what. So she came to India to talk to Gandhi about his views about women's sexuality and this thing. Gandhi said no scope. Sexual relation should end in conception. The contraception is something that he did not agree. So that is one area where Gandhi perhaps was not current at that time. In 1930, Gandhi stuck to his thing. But of course, he had some other reason for that. The only way India's population can be controlled, perhaps, was abstinence. No other method was there. The other methods, because oral contraceptive would be discovered only by 1947 or 50. By that time, Gandhi would be dead. And quantum also came much later. But then the cervical cap was discovered. Sankar was actually propagating that as a method of contraception. Gandhi naturally opposed it. And when Gandhi took a position against contraception, medical termination of pregnancy was illegal even in the United States. In fact, when oral contraceptive was marketed in 1946 or so, or 1946, when it was marketed in United States, the indication for the tablet, the pill, was menstrual irregularity, not contraception. So it took another 3 or 4 years to make contraception an indication for the pill. And then the moment pill became indicator for contraception, its sale went up from 1 million to 6 million. So there was a drastic improvement. Yeah. The other thing is breastfeeding. So he took it as a right issue. Oh, rights issue. So he understood about breastfeeding. He was very vocal about increasing the age of marriage of girls. He said the age of marriage should become at least 16, because at that time it was 10 or 9 and things like that. So he said it should be at least 16. So he supported that. He supported education for girls so that they would not become pregnant that easy. And he wanted cooking to come down. He propagated the idea of eating raw so that women will spend less time in the kitchen and they can spend more time outside for various other types of activity that will empower them. So all these things Gandhi thought of things, but in contraception he stuck to his position. He did not approve of contraception. So these are some other books about Mahatma Gandhi, which has just happened. This is a 2018 book, and this is about Gandhi's food habit alone. Very interesting book, Nico's Light. This was published a few months ago. So I have taken some references from all these books, and that is how we look at Gandhi. That is the great Gandhi. I am a 24-hour admirer of Gandhi, but I am not a Gandhian because I cannot become one. Thank you all.